So, first things first, when's the first time you came across Kostas Tsimikas?
To be honest, I haven't came across Kostas
Okay.
Tsimikas yet, because at our time in the national team, he was not the player that he is now. So, and because my spell in the national team was a little bit short, the moment Kostas has become very, very hot in the market, I wasn't in the national team, so I didn't have the time and the chance to speak with him and get across with him.
Okay, fair enough. But then I'm sure he's a player you would have been aware of over in
Yes,
Greece.
of course, of
When
course.
he
And
was, yeah.
his progress has been phenomenal. That's why this is the main reason that Liverpool came to sign him. Obviously, they show they have. They have been watching him for a long time, and especially the scouting system of these big clubs is very, very important. So they don't let anything. They don't rely in luck. You know, they are based in evidence, and all the evidence were there for Kostas.
When he was playing for Olympiakos, and I think when he was out on loan, could you see that talent there? Could he have been the sort of player then you'd see playing for a club like Liverpool, or has it just been this big rise where he's really unlocked his true potential?
I think he had a very, very rapid progress. I didn't think that many could see that very, very rapid progress that he made. He made very, very quick progress, very, very in a very, very short time. So, which is very, very impressive, and it's a big bonus for him as well. And as I said before, Liverpool have made a fantastic choice because they show in a very small period of time that they could rely in the talent on the talent of Kostas, which has more potential to give as well. I think the things that Kostas is doing now with Liverpool is only the beginning. I think he has a lot more to offer to the club.
When you were the Greece assistant, is he a player that was on the national team's radar then, or is it that it is that much of a big rise that he wasn't even on the international scene at that
No, no, no.
time?
He was in the radar. He was one of the players that would be in the agenda of the next collapse. Obviously, we could see among Kostas other players as well that could knock the door of the national team. And as I said before, Liverpool. Could obviously spot the qualities of Kostas, and they made a fantastic choice by offering him the contract that they did.
And I'm guessing as you haven't come across him, it's not something where he spoke to you at all before making the move to the Premier League. But obviously his first season didn't go as planned. So how tough is it to adjust to the Premier League? Like I believe you came from Olympiakos as well, didn't you? So to make that big step
Yes.
up from Greek football to English football, what's that like?
It's a completely different world. It's because you already know it's the toughest league in the world. Very, very physical, very, very fast. Both physically and technically. You need to combine these two elements at the same time. And this is the more difficult thing for a foreign player, especially a player that's coming from Greece. It takes a little bit of time to adjust in the pace, in the physicality of the game in England. And I think Kostas took his time. He had a couple of injuries that took him back a little bit, but now he's fully fit and he can demonstrate his potential and his God potential. This is what I like in him, and he's willing to work hard in order to get better better and better every day and every game.
And it's one where I suppose in the past, under previous managers, when a player has the first season he had without getting the opportunities, it would have been very easy for him to be sold or to leave on loan. But I think Liverpool's coaches, they're always saying he's doing so well in training, he just needs that opportunity. He's showing that now. He's had that time to settle and he seems to be in the form of his life.
Yeah. It's. I think this year is going to be his year. And don't forget that he has to compete with Robertson, yes?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Which is a fantastic player too. So the competition, as we say, the healthy competition between two very good players, like Robertson and Tsimikas, only has a benefit for the club. Both players, they are pushing each other for the first team spot. And that is a big benefit for Jurgen Klopp and the club as well, because they give their everything in the training, in the games, to show and to prove that they deserve to play. And that's very, very healthy and very good for the club.
What have you made of Kostas' start to the season?
What I've made? I think I'm not surprised, you know. I knew from the beginning that Kostas is going to make it because he has a big heart. He has determination. As far as I know, he works very, very hard, which is very, very obvious. And you can see that during the games. The games are the mirror of the training that you're doing week in, week out. So nothing comes along without trying. So he tries a lot and he deserves what he deserves, simply as that.
And what does it mean to the Greek national team to have one of their players playing so well for a club like Liverpool?
It's massive. It's massive for the Greek football. It's massive for the national team. It's the best advertisement of the Greek market, having players like Kostas playing for a club like Liverpool. You couldn't imagine a better advertisement for the Greek football in general.
And obviously Kostas is the second Greek to play for Liverpool, but I believe you could have been the first. Rafa Benitez tried to sign you in 2005. Just how close were you to a move to Liverpool?
You cannot imagine. I was so close that I couldn't believe that I didn't sign for the club. That would be the moment that I would have accomplished my biggest dream, to play for a club like that. But unfortunately, it was not in my hands, and it didn't happen. Despite I was speaking twice a day for a week. One time before the training, once before the training in the morning, and once after the training with Rafa to see if I was okay and not got injured in any training session for the transfer to take place. But unfortunately, and as I said before, it was not in my hands, so it didn't happen.
What sort of stuff was Rafa Benitez saying to you?
We had already agreed in my personal terms with his lawyer, and basically he was telling me to look after myself and don't get injured in the training, because in any time, any moment, the proposal would be in the desk of Big Sam or Phil Gardside, which was the chairman on them days of the club. But unfortunately, I don't know the reason, this proposal never came to the club, so it didn't happen.
And Phil Gartside, he spoke publicly quite a few times, I think, having a go at Liverpool, questioning how they were going about the move, saying that they weren't interested and they were interested. It must have been a very confusing, stressful time for you when you've got Phil Gartside saying one thing in the press and you know you're speaking to Rafa.
You know, it's sometimes some simple things look very complicated to the when they go public. The things were very, very simple. Liverpool wanted to sign me. It was very, very obvious. Like I said before, I was talking with Rafa Benitez every day. Unfortunately, this didn't work. I don't know the main reason that didn't work. And I stayed to the club that I loved very, very much, which was Bolton Wanderers. And I have three more fantastic years with the club, playing twice in European football with Bolton Wanderers, which would be a dream come true for the supporters of the club. So even though I didn't join Liverpool, I had three more fantastic seasons with Bolton Wanderers. So I'm happy.
And as you said, that you loved your time at Bolton Wanderers, and I think you went on to have your best season in terms of goals after the move didn't happen. But how is it you feel looking back now that you had that opportunity to join a club like Liverpool and it didn't happen? Are there any regrets there, or are you happy with how things turned out?
There is no regrets because it was not in my hand.
Mm-hmm.
I would have regrets if it was in my hands and I didn't take it. But because it was not in my hands, I cannot have any regrets because it didn't happen because I didn't want it to go. It happened because some other guys didn't want it to happen. You understand what I'm trying to
say?
So I cannot have regrets for something I didn't do.
And if you look at pretty much your whole time at Bolton, they always seem to have a very good record against Liverpool, against quite a few of the top teams. But I think particularly against Liverpool, they had a few wins at the Reebok. What was it that made your Bolton team so difficult to beat? And what was it that made sure that they were so successful against Liverpool?
It was not only Liverpool. If you watch carefully, you will see that Arsenal suffered many, many times when they visited the Reebok. So it was Arsenal as well that had very, very difficult times. And if you see the individuals that Bolton Wanderers had them days, it was full of European and World Cup champions. So it was not a small club, a small small team. Maybe the you know, the name of Bolton Wanderers was not so massive like Liverpool or Arsenal or United. But if you see the players, you will immediately understand that they were players that they were from the top shelf, I should say.
Mm-hmm. And one player you played alongside for a number of years at Bolton was Elhadj Diouf. Obviously, his time at Bolton, it was a lot more successful than his time at Liverpool. What was he like as a teammate, and why do you think it didn't work out for him at Anfield, whereas it did at Bolton?
I don't know. Sometimes if you go back and you see other players as well, for example, you can see Roberto Carlos. He played for Inter Milan, and maybe nobody knows or nobody remembers that he played for Inter Milan. And after he joined Real Madrid, and everybody knew who Roberto Carlos was and what he did for his club and country. So sometimes they don't match, they don't gel, the player and the club, and it simply doesn't work. I think this is one of the situations that suits Elhadj Diouf with Liverpool. It didn't gel, I should say. Because he was a fantastic player, great character, you know, very, very talented. And I think he could have made a very, very bigger career than the one that he already had done so.
Fair enough. And then just the last one, really. Obviously, you played at Anfield a number of times throughout your career. What was that like as an opposing player, and what are your memories of those games against Liverpool?
I think it's the best atmosphere that a player can live, can experience. The moment you are in the tunnel and waiting to go outside, and you hear the "you will never walk alone," your hair, your every skin of the skin goes up. I don't know how to express it, you know.
Mm-hmm. Hairs go up on the back of your arm.
Yes, exactly this. It's unbelievable. It's one of the moments that a player can never forget. And it's a dream to play, even as an opponent in Anfield Road. Imagine if you're wearing the shirt. It's like a gift from the football god.
This is the Blood Red Podcast from the Liverpool Echo.